pleasure to be here to speak to this MAX conference. And of course, I will discuss about non-equilibrium physics and about how non-equilibrium physics is related to HPC systems. So let me say that to run simulations on HPC systems and to design the code for HPC systems, it's sometimes a pain, but it offers also the opportunity to do simulations which are otherwise not possible. And it offers us the opportunity to do different kind of simulations in, I would say, four different directions, which I've represented here. First of all, we have the opportunity to consider from first principle larger systems, which we cannot describe easily within density functional theory. We can exploit HPC systems with high-throughput calculations. And for what Yambo is concerned, we can consider to use HPC systems to describe, for example, the mass structure of a system with higher accuracy. So here I mean that we can compute, for example, the quasi-particle energies instead of considering just the Kunesh-Yambo structure, or we can consider the Bethe-Salpeter absorption spectrum instead of the independent particle absorption spectrum. But another interesting opportunity is that we can consider to describe from first principles new physics, and here for new physics I mean out of equilibrium physics. So we can think of running first principle simulations of materials in highly non-equilibrium situations, which of course there is a lot of new physics, and these kind of simulations are very demanding. And this is what I would like to discuss about today. So I start with my introduction, which I used already a couple of times to explain what is non-equilibrium physics and ultra-fast physics. And I start with a picture of the human eye, because this is the instrument we mostly use to, let's say, to try to explore the world which is around us. And it is a very powerful instrument, but of course it has limitations both in space and in time resolution. And then we can use instruments to improve this limitation. So on the space side, the first attempt to overcome this limitation was done by Galileo in 1609. He was able, with a telescope, to observe the moons of Jupiter. And since then, of course, we did many progresses. So we moved from the telescope to the microscope, and then to the more modern scanning electron microscopy or transmission electron microscopy. And indeed, now we are able to take pictures of the single atoms. Here is a picture of a layer of graphene from 2011, so it's already some years ago. And this has, I mean, with this instrument, we can improve the resolution of our eye by a factor, which I would say is 10 to the 6, 10 to the 7. So what about the time side? And here I start with a portrait from 1791, representing a man on a horse which is running. And in this portrait, the horse is pictured as floating over the ground. And this is indeed the way the painter imagined the horse running, because he couldn't actually see the way the horse is running, since we cannot resolve with our eye a horse running at full speed. And if we compare this with instead the first movie of the history, I would say it was taken in 1878 in Palo Alto. It was indeed a series of 16 pictures of a horse running. And here we see that there is never a moment where the horse is floating with the legs stretched. So the closest situation to the picture is maybe this one, but the horse is always touching the ground. And just when the legs are, let's say, not stretched, the horse is floating over the ground while running. So this is a nice example of taking pictures in sequence, which we can somehow overcome the limitation of our eye. And of course, this was the first result. And well, how fast we can go. So I represent a few important moments. So this is the Nobel Prize which was given in 1967 for the invention of the photolysis method, which was invented some years before. And it enabled the observation of chemical reactions, so 10 to the minus 6 seconds, or 1 microsecond. So some years later, another Nobel Prize in 1999, this time, was given for the ability to observe femtosecond spectroscopy, actually close to picosecond spectroscopy. So we have been able to observe the motion of the atoms. Indeed, if we consider the atoms and if we consider the typical Coulomb interaction between two ions and the mass of the atom, from simple laws of classical physics, which we see that the time on which an atom moves is of the order of 100 femtoseconds. And beyond that, there is the dynamics of the electrons. So the electrons, using the Bohr model, we can see that they move on a time scale which is close to 1 femtosecond, a little below. And so this is the kind of physics that we can now try to observe with modern laser pulses. And here in this plot, I represent the time duration of laser pulses, which one can imagine to be used to take a picture of the electron dynamics. So here you see the time duration, and this is the period in which the fastest laser pulse was, say, created. And in particular, staying in the visible UV range, now we have reached the duration of below 10 femtoseconds. And this is the kind of experiment I would like to describe. So I have to say that if one goes in the X-ray instead, can even have pulses below 1 femtosecond, but for this presentation I will focus on this kind of physics, so with pulses in the visible UV range. And this is the kind of physics which can be described or measured with this kind of pulses. And it is of course related to electron dynamics. So here is the representation of the duration of the pulse, and here of the different kind of processes I would like to model from first principles. And one important observation is that if one tries to model this kind of physics with time-dependent density functional theory, basically one can describe the absorption of photons, the coherent dynamics which follows, but not much more of all these physical processes. And one of the reasons is that for TD-DFT in practice, we know the adiabatic approximation. This is well established, but we don't know how to use instead the frequency-dependent kernels in the equation of motion. And then it is harder to include all these kind of processes. And instead, if we move to many-body perturbation theory, we have a way to include all these kind of processes. Okay, so here is a picture of a typical pump and probe experiment where you can measure the electron's dynamics. So there is a first short pulse which is sent on the sample, and then the dynamics is activated, and after some time delay, a second pulse, which is in this case is photo-emitting the electron from the system, which is then detected. And changing the delay between the pump and the probe, one can try to have a picture of the dynamics of electrons. And this, I reported here a couple of papers where this kind of dynamics was measured in bulk silicon. And in particular, they pumped near the optical gap of silicon, so a direct injecting electron from the top of the valence band to the conduction band, and then measuring the intensity of photoemission signal from this point in the brilliant zone. And this, you see the picture of the intensity. And the simple mind interpretation is that electrons are injected here, or in this region, in this valley, from the pump pulse, which is here in red. And then electrons scatter from here to the minimum of the conduction band, so the signal goes down. And this is a simple interpretation, and I will show you how we can try to describe that, and if this matches with the first principles simulations. Another kind of experiment, which is similar in the spirit, so there is, again, a pump pulse sent to the material, and with a given time delay, a probe. But this time, instead of photo-emitting an electron, what is detected is the reflection of the probe signal. So this is an experiment which has been done, for example, in these two papers. Again, bulk silicon pumping near the optical gap. And in this case, I will consider, instead of the signal from this paper, a signal we got from a collaboration we have with Polytechnic of Milano. So this, you see a typical reflectivity signal. It is it depends on the frequency of the probe pulse. And it is represented at fixed delay between the pump of the probe. And of course, one could also change the delay and see how this profile changes. And I would like also to underline that pump and probe experiments are nice to see the electron dynamics, to see new physics, but there is also a strong technological interest because if you can control the electron dynamics, basically you can control the magnetization dynamics of the system. And magnetization is what is used to basically record information. So here in the picture, you see the way you can control magnetization, and the easiest way is using an external magnetic field, but with a laser pulse, you can even thinking about controlling the magnetization on a much shorter time scale. And indeed, there have been a lot of work. Here I'm just highlighting two papers where the control of magnetization using ultra-short laser pulses has been realized, and so it has been proposed the realization of an ultra-fast devices where one can read and write information on the femtosecond time scale. And even in this case, this is taken from this review, a proper theoretical framework to describe the ultra-fast dynamics remains challenging. So the message is that there are a lot of experiments which can be done with pump and probe setup. This is a tabletop setup, and which strongly need a proper theoretical description because it's not easy to describe this kind of experiment in an intuitive way. And not only tabletop experiments, but there are also experiments done at large facilities. For example, at the free electron laser. This is a picture of the FEL, which there is nearby here in Trieste. So how I would like to do all these from first principles? And the idea is that I want to start from a standard ground state calculation where I compute the equilibrium properties, so the bus structure of the system, and even the phonons and the electron phonon matrix elements. And then I would like to use that to describe the interaction with the pump, the scattering mechanism, and then eventually also the measurement process. How I do that in practice? I want to use many body perturbation theory. So I start from DFT, and then I want to merge the DFT with many body perturbation theory. So I use what we call ab initio many body perturbation theory, where the Konechan wave functions and the eigen energies are used as a zero order theory to construct the Green function and then to solve the equation for the many body perturbation theory. Of course, it is computationally very demanding, and this is why I say that HPC system can be helping that. But the nice thing is that it is an approach which is very powerful, predictive, and parameter-free. So this is how it works in practice in silicon. So here is the starting point, a representation of the band structure of silicon. I start with a DFT band structure, which is the dashed one. And then I compute the quasi-particle correction. Then I also compute the phonons dispersion. And then I plug these two ingredients together with the wave functions and the electron phonon matrix elements in my equation of motion. So what I solve is an equation of motion where there is explicitly the pump pulse, there is the equilibrium band structure, and there are all the many body correlations. And then, importantly, there is this scattering term which takes into account of the scattering processes, for example, with phonons in the system. It is an equation of motion, so I need, say, the equilibrium, the starting point, this is the starting point of my G lesser, which is nothing but the density matrix of the system projected on the Konechan bus structure. So these N, M, and K indexes are the indexes of the bus structure. I propagate the equation of motion, and I can extract different information, for example, the polarization. But mainly what I will use is the occupations on the bus structure as a function of time, and this time will be the time delay from the pump pulse, which can be obtained from the diagonal elements. And I can even use these occupations to construct the non-equilibrium linear response of the system, and then, for example, the absorption. So I come back to the experiment I was showing a few slides ago, these pump and probe experiments on silicon. We tried to simulate this experiment, and the first thing we realized is that if I apply a laser pulse to the system, to the bus structure of the system, this pulse is linearly polarized, and it will break some of the symmetries in the Brillouin zone. So what happens here is that the polarization of the electric field is directed along a precise direction, and then in particular the L points in the Brillouin zone of bulk silicon, they will not be all equivalent anymore. So here is a representation indeed of the band structure with both L and L prime. So the bands are the same, but what happens is that the pulse is mainly injecting electron around L and not at L prime, because for selection rules, the excitations of electron at L prime are forbidden. So after that, one can imagine what happens. There are two degenerate levels, one which is occupied and the other not, and there is a very fast transfer of electrons from L to L prime. So we did the simulation, and with that we were able to reproduce very nicely the time decay of the experiment. And just after there is disequilibration, then the electrons scatter to the minimum of the conduction band, and then eventually they cool. And connected to that, I would like to discuss also an interesting concept which emerges and which is related to the lifetime of a level. So here we were describing, and experimentally they were measuring, the time it takes an electron to go from an out of equilibrium state, L, to relax to the minimum. And we have used to think that the lifetime is related in many body perturbation theory to the imaginary part of the self-energy, which in photoemission is related to the width of a photoemission peak. So what I would like to compare is how this lifetime is connected with the simulation I did. And in particular, if I think that the lifetime is connected to the width, I'm thinking that the population of a specific level will decay in time with this specific lifetime. Which means I'm thinking this lifetime, this level, the population in this level is dictated by an equation of motion like this one. But indeed, doing the theory and the math, what one's obtained is an equation of motion like this one. And you see the difference here. So here the population is reduced in time by the electronic lifetime. And this describes what are called the out processes. But there is also another term, which is zero at equilibrium, which describes the processes of electron jumping in the level, because there can be electrons in other points of the bus structure. So if I want something which matches this idea, I can simply divide and multiply by the electronic occupation and write an effective equation with this lifetime, which now has this form, and it will be time dependent. So what I can do is to compare this effective lifetime with the equilibrium lifetime during my simulation, and here is a plot. So this is the equilibrium lifetime, and this is the effective lifetime at L. And we see that at the beginning of the simulation, they are very close, so the pump is pumping electron just here, and so the electron can scatter mostly everywhere in the Brillouin zone, and so the lifetime is very close to the equilibrium concept. But then after some time, this channel is closed. And it is closed because electrons can still jump here, but there will be also electrons jumping back this all the lifetime. And so there is a faster drop of the lifetime in energy, so it becomes much longer in time. Okay, another nice thing that I can do is I can take my population and I plot them as a function of the energy at different time steps, and this is what is pictured here. So here is the population in the conduction band. At equilibrium I have no electrons, it is zero. And then the pump pulse starts to inject electrons in the conduction band. And in particular, also here, I see that the occupation of the L level is much higher than the occupation of the L prime level. And then, since there are electron phonon scattering process, the electrons spread everywhere in the mass structure. And this is what is happening here. So the L and L prime levels are the same now. And then they go towards the minimum, and they start to form a Fermi-like distribution with a temperature which is then decreasing because my system is giving energy to the lattice. So the electrons are cooling. At the beginning, the temperature is very high. And for the moment in the simulation, the temperature of the lattice is kept fixed at equilibrium. And so you see that the system is cooling and cooling. And then if I go on with the simulation, it will eventually reach the temperature of the lattice. OK, maybe I can stop here. I had also the other experiment, but I think I will not have time. So I would like to mention that all these results are part of a collaboration. So I'm working with Andrea Marini at the CNR-ISM. And we are doing both theory and code developing with the YAMBO code. We have a collaboration with Enrico Perfetto and Gianluca Stefanucci, which also are doing using non-equilibrium green functions. And they also have their own code, which is called CIRS, which is meant for models or isolated systems. And recently, we have interfaced the two codes. And then that we are also using the coding collaboration with a group in Modena, Margherita Marsili, who is now who left science now, but did part of the simulations on another material, which I didn't discuss today. And Alejandro Molina Sanchez in Spain is also using the code for doing a simulation. And that's it. Thank you, and a list of references.